What do you think? I just think you ought to, because this lecture course has surveys in the has survey technique in the notes in the course material, and so therefore understanding how surveys are set and also understanding, well, critiquing the survey, what questions were asked, why they asked, do they give you the labels, do they give you the correct questions that you would set. So you could you can be, by being a participant, you can make a critique of that survey. So I think it's a useful thing to do. Okay, so today you're going to do some things in groups as well as the standard thing, just for a few little 5 minute segments. So first of all though, let's have a pop quiz from last week. So, what is a scientific method and why is it important? So who wants to tell me what scientific method is first of all? Nobody knows what the scientific method is. Nobody knows one major part of the scientific method, created by Karl Popper. You need to have a testable hypothesis. So you need to be testable and to be refutable. Okay, that's the first thing. Okay, what else do we think about science, the scientific method? Nobody knows anything more about scientific. Last week, were you all secretly dead? Or what?
Was it that you make hypotheses that ought to be challenged?
Yes, you make hypotheses ought to be challenged. We're trying to break the system. Now, the stuff that we did on hypotheses last week, where we showed the video, then, you know, we had a hypothesis there that people were initially trying to support, but the reality is that gives you less information than trying to break it. Okay? So that is the aspect, that's one of the key hard points of the scientific method. So for this kind of work, why is the scientific method important? Why is the scientific method important?
Yes. It helps us know if we've got a good user experience.
It helps us know if we've got a good user experience because it gives us directly testable claims. That's the first thing. More pragmatically, why else is it important? What kind of world did Ted and Nelson say that we live in? But I mentioned this like loads of times. So his famous quote was, people are pretty much stupid, authorities are lying, and everything is wrong. If everything is wrong, then we need some way to understand whether that's what's really correct. That should be the starting point, your critical analysis. Okay, so you guys need to increase your game. If you look at the videos from last year, I'm going to find that there's something to do with this lecture. But if you're looking at last year's videos, as I was actually told by a number of students, you said, wow, last year's are far more talkative than this year's, aren't they? And the answer is yes. Okay. So, be more talkative, understand this word. What do we mean by internal, let's say, what do we mean by internal validity? Internal validity, yeah. So it's looking at the data set that we've got and seeing how consistent the internal it is. So is this internally consistent between multiple sets of people, between individuals within that data? Or is the, or if not talking about individuals, the data itself, how holistic, how coherent is it? So what kind of statistics might we use to look at internal, we spoke about them last week, to think about internal validity? What kind of numbers might be, what kind of functions might be used?
Averages and deviations.
averages, standard deviation, variance. What we're looking for is variance, measures of variance. So the problem with, say, an average is that you could have, it can be very affected by outliers, obviously. So therefore it's useful to have standard deviation to understand what the general deviation is through all of them, to see how consistent the whole is, all of the data is. Why does internal validity matter? Why does internal validity matter?
It's a quantifiable measure.
It's a quantifiable measure, yes, that's true. So, but why does that measure matter, yes?
You've got a huge variance, and it's not very... The closer it is to me, the better. I mean, it's not very... It's the same for everyone.
Yes. That's right. So therefore, even the small data, which you're going to have lots of small data. I mean, you know, as we were saying, the number of participants you're going to get in a user study for your UX study is very small if you actually get to do it. So it might be between, 10 and 15 people. You'd be very lucky to get 30 to 40. It's almost unheard of to get to 100. And, you know, we never get anything like we want to get in medical science, which is, 20,000. Okay. So, the thing we need to think about is the internal consistency, because the more consistent the data is internally, the more likely you are to be able to say to be confident about the results of the data. All this stuff is about how confident you are about something. That's what we're trying to get to. If you're not confident about the data, about the results that are coming back from the data, because the data is spread very widely and there's lots of variance in that data, then you've got to think to yourself, well, even though the average looks good, is this really good? Is it a really good thing to do? Is this really good data? Can we say anything from the data that comes back? And the answer is probably not. You've got to quantify what you're saying. So the average might look excellent. You know, the low might look okay. But if you've got lots of variation, then that's a problem. What do we mean by external validity then? Yes. Yes, how it applies to the whole population. So what you're trying to do is generalise to a population. So what's the difference between sample and a population? Yeah.
Population is like a whole set of people. So you're in a one set of people, but a sample is a subset of that.
Right, so the population is a whole set of people that you want to experiment over, and the sample is just a subset of that. And if you've included the population, then that's called a census, obviously.
That's
different,
okay?
So, for instance of a population. Give me an example of a population. Yeah?
People in the UK.
People in the UK, okay? So that's a population. And you've defined that population. The thing you also need to think about is that you have to define what your population is for us to know how to draw the sample. So you're saying people in the UK, every age, every gender, every nationality, all you have to do is live in the UK. Right, so that's the population that we need to draw from. So you might then restrict your population to something more specific or targeted. You might say students between the age of 18 and 30 and 24 or 25 who are doing an undergraduate degree at a Russell Group University. That would also be a valid population. Yeah. Okay. Why is external validity important? No. Talked about external validity, I've talked about generalizability or you guys have to go to school. What's that mean? So what? Scientists and dicks. Oh man, people think scientists are dicks no matter what they do. There's no getting away from that. No, well, so people don't think scientists are dicks. Okay. Yeah.
To protect participants and experimenters.
So protect the participants and experimenters? Yeah, that's one way to put it there. It's not necessarily for me, one thing is that we might actually put people in harm's way if we do the medical experiments, for instance. So there is...
Yeah, that's as far as the reason would be.
Yeah. Yeah, reasonable.
Yeah.
So that's remembering your hypothesis, reasonable, but that's not testable, because it relies on subjective. So, yeah.
And as far as the end, so this kind of implicit relationship with...
Yes. So the real reason why this is useful, why I suggest that the single measure is all the so that we get good science. That's right. The reason why is because if the science is bad, there's no point, that's the starting point, there's no point in doing anything. So if the science hasn't been checked, if the whole system and how it's going to be evaluated hasn't been checked by others, hasn't and you've not thought about it correctly, then there's no point in doing the evaluation, because even though you're going to try and make sure that that nobody's disadvantaged, the data that you get back will implicitly disadvantage those people due to the fact that the data will be wrong, the analysis will be wrong, the outcomes will be wrong, and you are therefore wasting people's time, you have put them through procedures which they might find uncomfortable. Okay. So, for me, for a lot of other people, the primary point of the ethical procedure, one of the primary things, is to ensure good science, because without good science, nothing else matters. Or everything else is junk. We put people through certain kinds of procedures, obviously oftentimes in agreement. We put people through those procedures quite a lot, where it might be, or it might seem to be detrimental. If you're in the drug trial and you're having a placebo, then you're not actually getting any treatment. Okay. So that might be disadvantageous. Well, probably is disadvantageous to you. So for original thought and creativity, in the news this week, what was, obviously I'm sure you're all avid Radio 4 listeners. All in the Mind, you should all be listening to All in the Mind on Radio 4. I don't know. So, on the news, what kind of thing might you link this kind of ethical, because you link some of this ethical stuff too, for your additional thought question of 20%? From other domain? Yeah.
Science behind trying to work out where this plane's
disappeared. Okay, the science behind trying to work out where this plane's disappeared too, yeah. So that's one way you could link to this kind of stuff. Anything else? If it was me, I'd be thinking about linking to the medical procedures, to the stated ambition of medical procedures to reduce the amount of testing or the testing necessary before a drug goes to that could save the lives of very terminally ill people. Might save those lives by missing out some steps at the end. Okay, the marketing steps at the end. And there's a big discussion about whether this is a good thing or a bad thing. You might come to a conclusion, it's for volunteers, but you might come to a conclusion different to others. Some people think that this should occur. Other people think that it should occur. Okay. Have you heard that in the news? You've heard nothing about the news. Okay. What are the 8 key ethical principles? So give me an ethical principle. What do we need to ensure as part of that is? Yeah. Okay, we keep the data up to date.
It's
okay. we all have to keep as experimenters, as specialists, our competences, key competences up to date. Okay? That's a big ethical thing for medicine, if you're a medic. It's a big ethical thing for us in computer science as well. If you're a BCS member or IET member, you have to keep your key competences up to date. Because obviously if you're working on medical equipment, or if you're working on surgical equipment, if you aren't competent, then you're likely to affect people's lives. Okay, any others? Confidentiality, a very good one. We have to maintain confidentiality. Okay? So that's one major thing we have to think about. How are we going to maintain confidentiality with regard to the data? What might we do if we're storing that data on electronically, Excel sheets or SPSS data sets? Yeah?
Encrypt it,
so you can have it encrypted. So that's one thing, yeah?
Anonymize it,
that's another thing, so it's encrypted and anonymized. Once it's anonymized, you might be okay at letting that be shareable. Open data is a big thing, and there's research councils now, and a lot of companies, we have to share that data because it depends who's paid for the data, so therefore, we have to anonymize it, which means that we can share it, but if you have anonymizing, pseudo-anonymizing as well, where you have encrypted demographic information about the person themselves, okay, about the participant, with a random number which links their answers to their actual real data. And in this, who they are, their identifying data, if you like, you can encrypt the identifying data and open up the anonymized data, the pseudo-anonymized data. Okay, so that being the case, if you've anonymized data and it's not pseudo-anonymized, just as a quick aside for your critical, your original thought, again, and you've got pseudo-anonymized data, so you've opened, well, you haven't got pseudo-anonymized data, so what you do is you go asking people themselves, well, give me some answers, but you don't know anything about them after that. What does that imply for their ability to have control over that data? Why do you have to let them know, yeah? That's right. So that means that they don't have control. Once they've given consent, they can't withdraw consent. Okay. Now the difference is that in lots of situations you might not get that theoretical approval because it may be that people wish that you have to have a certain number of hour period for people to withdraw the data if they think better of it, cooling off period. So you might say that you'll fully anonymize their data after 2 weeks or something. So at that point you then just throw away Okay, yes, you have a question as well. Okay, well remember there's 8 ethical principles you should be thinking about. We're not going to go through all of them because time's running out. Why is conforming to scientific principles key to good ethical design? So, up here, we had a little discussion, and down here, I'm now doing the opposite of this, pretty much telling you if you're really asking me for the other way, so there should be silence, because I'm giving you the answer. Yeah?
You didn't do good science, it's not really the point in what you're doing, it's not really ethical, just doing the hell of it.
Yeah, that's right, so if you're not doing good science, then there's no point in doing it, and it's not ethical just doing it badly. Okay? So these questions might be asked on the exam in a different way to the way that you're expecting. Okay? So they can have a reciprocal, if you like, question. Okay, so let's go on to the next topic, and this one is kind of the last topic in this evaluation, these two lectures, last topic in evaluation lectures. Next week we'll be going on to look at in real life, so how this really works in real life. But at the moment we're going on to this. So hat racks for understanding, remember back to hat racks for understanding and the different kinds of ways that we're going to elicit information. Okay? So let's have a look at some of these first of all as a recap. Participant observation, who wants to tell me what that is? But when you go into a company and you want to understand how that company, you know, how people in that company interact, what they do, and you want to know it from a deep level, you might go in and, be, and observe observe people, okay, in that company. You go in there. It's normally, is it a long or short time? Long or short? Participant observation, long or short? Participant observation, long or short. Also, where does participant observation come from? Where does participant observation come from? Ethnography, anthropology. If it comes from ethnography and anthropology, how long do you think it's likely to last?
Last, like, anywhere, at least 6 months.
Yeah, that's a long time. I mean, even an ethnographer would laugh, they would. Laugh at 6 months. It's not 3 years, it's not proper. It's not proper. But we don't have 3 years. Okay. So generally, it's we want to spend a good length of time there.
What on earth are they doing for 3 years? That just seems like.
What are they doing for 3 years?
Well,
if you've got to. It depends what you mean by. You mean 3 years in the computer setting or 3 years in general? So if it's 3 years in general, want to try and understand a society by 20 people within that society who you know their lives inside out and are with them all the time, then it can take a long time to get that rich data because that's why.
Because you spend too long and then kind of sort of bias to sort of
fruitful.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, yeah. And there's lots of
friendships or whatever.
Yeah. That's right. And you can become biased, you can have certain friendships, there's a decoupling effect which occurs. It's also principles of sometimes people have issues with ethics because if you're in a group and then you leave that group, the people who are left feel very bereft because you left. You say therefore you're kind of disadvantaging them because you just cut yourself off and you left. If you try and move out of that group stage by stage, you might have unintended consequences. Some groups you can't leave. If you're looking at gang culture, that's very difficult to leave the gang. If you're looking at gang culture, if the gang know that you're an ethnographer and you're not really part of it, you've only been there for a long period of time, it can be very difficult to leave that gang or be asked to do things that are illegal, you know that. So it can take a long period of time. It's called actually the most. So ethnography used to occur, well, really, mostly anthropology, ethnography in the 18th century. It used to be called veranda anthropology. Veranda ethnography, because all that happened is that you go to your bungalow in Borneo or somewhere, sit on your nice veranda, and then you get people to come to you because they have the choices, you were in control. And that seems obviously a really bad thing. And then we had the Chicago School and also the Manchester School, which through the 30s to the 60s did this thing which was very into deviant behaviour, deviant cultures, which they considered to be deviant, such as drug taking, gang culture, that kind of thing, and it took a long time. That's where a lot of this came from. It takes a long time to know a culture. Could we know a culture in 6 months? We could know a lot of it, maybe, but we couldn't know the richness of a lot of the cultural aspects, so that's why it takes a few years. Okay. Task analysis. By the way, if anybody asks a question, expect to get a long and rambling response because that's just who I am. I'm academic, that's what I do for a living. Yeah.
If you're observing in like 6 months, would you not end up sort of becoming sort of too ingrained in what they do and not be able to sort of abstract yourself and think how you can do it better?
Yeah.
You can become.
Oh, yeah. It's very difficult. But once you actually feel it, once you feel you're part of a group, then it can become very difficult. And oftentimes you have to have a day out or maybe 2 days out a week where you come to sit in your home base, if you like, so that you can realise who you really are and that you're kind of part of this but you're not part of that sort of thing. And that you're leaving. Yeah.
I guess it depends on a lot of the context, like in the voice loop case study, the course they were presumably only sending shuttle missions up. They weren't doing it every week, they have the simulations as well, but to observe the real one, you have to wait for quite a long period of time.
Yeah, that's true. So sometimes you don't control the time period. You have to just go along with what's there. But yeah, that's right. It might be that you're looking at thought works. thinking about the ThoughtWorks example, you might be looking at how spikes get run in the company, say, in the software company. Well, you have to wait for those events to occur, you can't be part of it. But you have to be also embedded enough to be invisible, kind of. So embedded means invisible and embedded for machinery, for stuff. And so you need to be kind of embedded, you need to be invisible, so that people aren't conscious that you're observing. And that often is difficult to do without spending time with people. Okay, testing analysis. What's testing analysis? And is it shorter or longer than participant observation? Yeah.
Short.
It's short, good. And why? And what is it? Task analysis, we're given a set of tasks already pre-found. Okay? So in participant observation, we don't know anything. We don't know what task energy is doing or anything else. Task analysis is we sort of see what tasks, we're just focused on the tasks that people are doing. So we can quickly get a load of tasks. It's quite short, task analysis. Now we analyse those tasks and how they're doing, disregarding most of your stuff. So, what do you think task analysis, where do you think task analysis kind of came from? Time and motion. Time and motion is sort of business work where we're looking at how tasks are not really considered in, they're not really considered in a interesting scenario because it's a short time. Okay, focus groups. Long or short? Yeah.
Sure.
Short. And focus groups, what do you have to think about? What might you be worried about in focus groups?
Misleading data. So I would say the focus groups and the new program. When everyone's asked, this is good. They were trying to impress whoever was the authority figure at the time.
Yeah.
And they want to impress that person by saying what they did.
Yeah, that's good. So generally, focus groups, people want to impress the experimenter because they know that the experimenters, by their body language, have an outcome they want because it's not double blind, and it's good that you the code to it. That gets you only 20% of your extra marks. Yeah.
Be sort of more biased towards the loudest.
Yes, you can get more biased towards the loudest people in the room. So if somebody's got a very definite opinion, other people will start to, if you like, will start to have the same opinions as those sort of strong individuals. Now, I think the name. Do you see the old school film called, what's it called? What film am I thinking of? It's called 12 Good Men. 12 Angry Men, that's right. 12 Angry Men. Who's seen 12 Angry Men? Right, yes. And is that an excellent sequel? I think you've been thought as well. 12 Angry Men, that is all about the person with the most, with the loud. But for whatever reason they have, it's all about the person with the loudest voice controlling the day, or trying to, in some way. For whatever reason, that might be, even if it's not biased. Who's around Zen and the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance? Who's read, put your hands up, who's read Zen and the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance? Who started reading Zen and the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance? Nobody's read it.
I've heard of it.
Oh my lord. Get this book, spend time reading it just so that you'll have something more interesting than notes to read. Does anybody know it? No. Very bad. Right. Interviews. What do you think about interviews? How are they, superficial or not superficial? Yeah.
They're very formal. They're quite superficial. You don't get down into exactly how things work. You just sort of all the questions you've got. So.
Yeah, so people are kind of answering the questions you've got. They're kind of superficial, a bit surface, then you kind of know what you're doing. What, if you wanted to be more lax on the structure, less formal, because you don't know all the questions, what might you call that?
Like an informal chat.
An informal chat, and what's it called?
Conversation with purpose.
Conversation with purpose is what it's called. So we might have a conversation with purpose, whereby we start a conversation with a purpose, and you decide, this is how I'm going to continue with that purpose. Social. What's social? Social. That table at the back there, you guys are asking me to answer too many questions. You're under my field of vision, you see. That's the problem that I'm still going to say. Yes. Social. Clue. You know this inductive reasoning you were talking about, and how you're, you know, the premier computer science university in the UK, in England, actually. Okay. So you're all here, the premier computer science university in England. 32nd in the world, and we can't make an inductive reason of what social data collection is. Jesus, what do you think it is? Yes. Yes, absolutely right. So asking more conversations with a purpose, having conversations with a purpose within a social background. The people having a social event, then it's far more likely they'll tell you the reality of the situation. Give somebody a couple of pints on Friday night and they'll be telling you everything that's wrong with the system that's occurring at the moment, and everything that's right, and everything, all the honest politics too. Okay? That's how it used to be, and we used to be anything you control about the system. It just gets so much data. Yeah.
Is that very ethical?
Oh, yes. Yes. It's very ethical as long as they know that you're an experimenter. So what they're saying is what they're saying. You also have to know that you're going to be confidential about what you're doing. So you can say, you're not going to be going on Monday night and say, Fred said to me when we were drunk on Friday night that this system's crap. You're not going to say that because that would be ethical, but it might then give you some way to point to. Archive. If you don't have very many people, then archival work is going through past documents. Okay, so this is taking longer than I imagined. Right, dissemination. This is how we're going to get information that we've collected to the people who need it, right? I.e. software engineers. Because for this moment, for this stuff, you guys are going to not be software engineers. Okay? You've got to be out of software engineers. Now, you should also know that out of the staff student committee, apparently, just want to know, I'm also looking for people who are on their computers and smiling. If you're smiling on your computer, it means that you're not paying attention properly. According to the reps, the staff student committee reps, I've got to look out for that. User stories. What's a user story? It's not like I'm saying abracadabra, that's a user story. I mean, what is it? It says it in the title. Yes?
First hand account of the user using the system.
Yeah, so it's the account of the user using the system. Okay? So what makes a piece normally long or short?
Short.
Quite to the point, aren't they? Can have them written on cards, etc. A bit like news cases. Okay? But use cases are long. What's the difference between user stories and use cases? Yeah.
Use cases are a more detailed procedure. What actually happens in the user story, right? In a use case.
Yeah, so a use case is far more as a more detailed procedure, right? Okay, so it's more specific. So use cases might be very useful if you've done task analysis and you've got a very definite task analysis that you want to then convey to a software engineer. If you like, you're being the translators, you have to step out of this software engineering role that you might think of yourself as and be your UX. Decoupled from the development side. Okay, persona, what's a persona? What's the intention of a persona? Yeah.
Yeah,
it's to give it a flavour. It's to kind of put you in the... It's to make, I know it's difficult in computer science, but it's to make us computer scientists empathise with a person, okay, with this set of people. Kind of, so we can understand their problems. Yeah. And the scenarios are linked to that because we can understand not tasks, but the kind of things that people want to do. Not the things that people want to do, but the kind of things that people want to do. Wireframe, have you used wireframes in your third year projects? Yes? Anybody done wireframes? Yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah, good. Anybody else? Just written in your books and then scanned it in, put that into your user design? No? Okay, so what about URL? Who's done URL in your second year software engineering? Everybody. So there's only a few people with their hands up, but everyone's done it. URL. Okay. What do you think to URL compared to personas? Or do you prefer to consider compared to the news case? What would I critical description be? Yeah.
Much more formal and structured.
Much more formal, much more structured. Is it likely that you have to know something about the system that's being created to sort of have an interaction? It is. So therefore, if you've gone to UML, you've kind of passed the transition from being a software UXer to being more of a software engineering UXer. So you know what system, you've probably got some input into its development if you're able to model this. Here, we're trying to be as vanilla as we like. So up here, we're trying to be kind of vanilla. We're trying to say, well, this is what the users say. This is what we think we've got from this data collection. And this is what now we're going to give to software engineers. Software engineers might then say, well, I'm going to formalize all these as UML, or state transition, or flowchart. These bits here are really about the wireframe, the mock-up, and the storyboard, but more really about the visual look and feel, the auditory look and feel, if you like, the sensory look and feel, how it all fits together, and the interactions that go with them. Where you're going to move from one thing to the next. Okay? Where people would like to move from one thing to the next. But it doesn't define how things are going to be put together, or the functionality of those things yet. Okay. Now, there's two things here. Walkthroughs and heuristic evaluation. I want you to think about heuristic evaluation. What do we think heuristic evaluation is? Now we come on to the evaluation component. Heuristic evaluation, the walkthrough is where you walk a person through a set of interactions or interactivity and solicit and wait for them to give feedback. Heuristic evaluation is based on your expertise as experimenters. If you haven't got anybody, then you can think about best practice principles. Okay? And you can see how that relates to what's been designed by the software engineers. Yes?
Another set collection of theories that your designer should conform to.
Yes.
Someone's proposed previously.
Yeah. So these are things which are set. Which are set theories that people have already defined. They also come from our building principles, so we've got lots of building principles, so you might want as an expert to go through looking at those building principles. So, we've got 5 minutes now. Shouldn't have taken as long as this. But, 5 minutes. What questions would you ask if you were of yourself? What things would you think about when you're looking at a system that, say, a software you need to build? You're there doing the initial work through, you're creating your report to say that you as a software engineer, as a UX specialist, think this is good. What kind, come up with a list of the kind of things that you would keep in mind. What things would you think this system should need to conform to from your knowledge of the, let's say, the building principles that we've been through. We've already been through accessibility, usability, and gamification, dynamism, engagement, that kind of thing. We've obviously got in 2 weeks the effective emotional stuff to do. But just for those 3 lectures, what kind of things should you be thinking about when analysing a system based on your own? You've given a system that's been developed, you're the expert, somebody says, I want your expert opinion on this system. What things should you be keeping in mind? You've got 5 minutes, that's going to be 49. So let's get, so I'll be coming around and asking each table for their list. And I will be asking each table for this. So if you're not on a table with people, I want a list. from you guys. That is our talk.
Working on the system.
doing a Christian calibration, you're sat there with the machine in front of you. You need to make those decisions about how what you think based on your knowledge of the people who might be using it. Okay? So that's something you need to think of. Good. Okay? Number two.
The amount of time required to complete the task.
Okay. Experimentation, I'm not going to get into this because I haven't got a lot of time. But read the notes. Okay, so short-term memory, working memory,
yes.
That's right. Okay, so we're saying the task completion time and working memory. Task completion time, where does that come from? Is that traditional or non-traditional, if you like? Traditional HCI because it's very quantitative. Yeah, so just a little bit. So two more. Okay, accessibility, can you change the size of it? Where might you find those guidelines specifically? From your notes, that's true, but also from the ISO standards, right? Okay? Compatibility of screen readers, okay, yeah, so you need to make sure that your APIs are open so that screen readers can get to your data set, to your interface. Yes?
The type of people that will use the system.
So
their experience that they might have.
The experience that they've got, that kind of thing, that's useful. Yeah, good. And what else? Okay, so you want to increase the user experience by seeing if there's any kind of touch points or points of contact. Yeah. Okay, good, yeah, touch points, yeah. Go to this table.
Is it restrictive?
Is it restrictive?
In a way that throws horrible layers and convoluted nouns.
Yeah, okay, is it restrictive? Yeah, okay, and what's the next one?
Consistent.
Consistent, that's a good one, consistent. Because consistency encourages familiarity. If we're familiar with it, we don't need to learn so much. Good point, yes. Okay. So that also links into familiarity and consistency with both the system that they're used to and also the operating system that it's built on.
Yeah, and then how long do they spend using the system?
Okay, and you guys have all put this together. Okay, right. Was it designed? Was it owned in the user center? Obviously, as we know from Jeff Raskin's quotes and work, you need to spend less time documenting if you actually make sure that the system reflects what the user wants, because it's more familiar. Okay. Now you're kind of the biggest table, so you get the hardest bits.
What's the more
familiar? what's the mode of input, so designing for an understanding of the technology. So that's one of these three things that we looked at. So obviously in user experience, and when we're looking at this, you've got to take into account the user situation of use and also the technology that they're going to be using, people are going to be using. That's from Lovey and Krasinski, 2006. Yeah, good. Okay. Good. So that's good. Boris bikes, you need to think about the environment of use, so therefore if you've got sort of Boris bike stuff on your mobile phone, then it's a bit of a problem to find that when you're riding, so it should be on some of the device, yeah? That's a good one for this bit.
Is the system like a
machines, okay, for your evaluation. There's different kinds of field work whereby we do other things, whereby we have this thing called in situ or in the wild, okay, evaluation. So while you've been there collecting your data for what people do, it's a bit of a problem sometimes to actually give them a system to work on in this kind of rarefied environment of laboratory or in their own workplace. And expect them to use it as they normally would. Okay, while you're there, loads of cameras, blah blah blah. Okay, can be a little problem. So what's now useful, what now people are doing is this thing called in situ in the wild stuff, evaluation. So what you do is you have a system that's ready to go into the wild, you stick it in the wild, and you let people use it and see how it actually responds. Two things. In fact, three things I imagine here that you could link to other kinds of software engineering that you might do where this might not be, where you could say that this is already happening. Yes?
User acceptance testing.
User acceptance testing, yeah, okay, so that's one. What about the kind of stuff that you're used to in development methodologies? Yeah.
Agile, you release every
iteration
so
that they're working properly. That's right, so if you're using Agile, then you're releasing it in very, very small iterative releases, right? So therefore, you're going to be able to fix any bugs or fix any problems with the interface because of these small, tight samples, okay? Which means that's a good thing because it means that you haven't bought into the code base yet. If you've written the whole thing, you don't want to change the code base because it's your baby, okay? But when you've just done it for creating a bit of code for a week, then, or 2 weeks, you know, change the interface, you don't mind changing things so much because you haven't brought ownership of that interface that you've created yet. It's like when you're writing an essay. Most people, when they start writing essays, won't get rid of words. Even if they write words that are crap, and they know they're crap, they won't get rid of it because they've written it. It's something. Okay? Even though it doesn't say anything about anything. We'll do that, yes.
It's funny enough, when I'm writing a piece of coursework, I found that the longest amount of time was when I sort of got all my ideas and appeared in the kind of sort of find out the filter that I might have taken, you know, a couple of hours to sort of write me and talk about it, and then spent the more time after there and reading, you know, either you can type it and it's hard to throw it away, and it probably would just be easier to, you know, put your ideas down, toss it off, keep writing, and you got one out of right.
Yeah. That's true, you see the words there and you think, these are excellent. Sometimes think these are excellent, sometimes you know they're crap, but yeah, they're right. You're doing the writing. It just takes time to sort of, you know, be okay with the way to write it. And that's also the same with coding. It's the same with interface design. You've got this really nice design, you spend lots of time doing this really nice design, and then they don't like it. God damn, they've got to like it because you've put all this effort into it. So if you can do it in 2 week cycles, or week cycles, or month cycles, there's less chance of you being so involved in that design. And then the other thing that I want you to think about here is look back to the coursework we've already done, look back to some of the lessons we've already learned through usability. Join those two parts together. So tell me something about Xerox Star. that relates to this.
Prototype machine I had a couple of weeks ago, so that was out in like in situ in the wild, just imagine doing.
Yeah, they were eating their own dog food, so their own stuff they used, okay, and they used it as an in wild study for a long time, okay. So that's what you also need to think of. The in wild, the eating your own dog food is a good thing to do. If it's in your company, then you can actually sort of have control over it, it's not released yet. Still in very early alpha, not even that maybe. But it means that you're able to then make changes quite quickly. Okay. So we come to this thing now which is called unobtrusive. So everything that a lot of the things we've spoken about are obtrusive. It means they know they're being experimented over. You're asking them questions, you've given them an interview, blah blah blah, about what kind of experience they're having. Okay? But what we want to do is remove that. So the good thing about in the wild studies, in-situ studies, is this. Problems with normal observations are guinea pig effect. So people feel like guinea pigs, therefore change their behaviour. Okay, we've already seen that. We already know that. They feel under pressure, and so they change their behaviour from what they would normally do. And they give you answers in focus groups which toe the party line, you know, but that doesn't necessarily mean that that's truthful. Role selections, so it's participants in the experiment as having elevated status and therefore follow the experimenter's lead. From last week, how do we get rid of role selection if we can? What's a good way of trying to get rid of role selection? Yeah.
Double blind studies.
Yeah. Because that way they can't follow the experimenter because the experimenter doesn't know what the outcome is supposed to be, what outcomes required. Measurement has changed, so aspects of experiments induce real changes. Oh, it's a bit quantum mechanics, this isn't it? Schrodinger's cat, ooh. But let's not go that far. But anyway, yeah, measurement changes, so aspects of experiment can induce changes to what you get. Because, say if you're doing task analysis, and then what you want to do is, you've done your task analysis, you conveyed that task analysis as a use case to a software engineer. Software engineers created it as a UML diagram. Okay, and then they've coded it. There's lots of points where the message can be diluted, lost, or changed from the user to the endpoint. Okay, so therefore, we go back and we try and measure this stuff. But what we're trying to do is measure a specific, how it conforms to what the software engineer thought the task was, not what the user thought the task was. So because we're doing this measurement, then it might be that we want to get a quantitative outcome, but really the user doesn't care about the quantitative outcome, they only want a qualitative one. Is this a good experience? They're not bothered whether they can do it in 5 seconds or 5 or 3 seconds. All they wanted it to be a better experience than it originally was. Okay? So by measuring it, it can seem right, it can seem that it conforms with what the software engineer has specified specifically. But that might not be a good thing to think about. Okay. Response sets. Respondents will more frequently endorse a statement than disagree with its opposite. Okay? So, if I say you've got a 5% in this procedure, you've got a 5% chance of getting it wrong, more people are likely to be worried about that than if I say you've got a 95% chance of getting it right. So I'm using two terms, right and wrong, to do the right away. Yeah? They're like true, not false. It's just the way it goes. So you can make people respond positively or negatively depending on the terminology that you're using. And so, in saying, if you're asking questions, you might want to put the same question twice but in opposition somewhere else in the thing so that you can control for that. All of this is about control too. How can you control for the data? Yeah.
Perhaps on the world like kind of reactants where people will tend to do the opposite of what they're asking to the perceived attempt of your experience.
I've heard of that. it's something that people say, but when you look at the data doesn't support it very much, because mostly people have taken the experiment because they're not trying to get out cerebral, because they want to do it all the time, because they're self-selecting in some way, or they're happy to do the work, but they're not compelled to do it. So they're thinking positively, kind of, anyway. Okay, we're going to have a thing here to do the 5 minute thing to look at the design criteria and act it, but we're not, because we're running late. So the final thing of this little bit before coffee is longitudinal observation. We've obviously got that. But let's see what we think longitudinal observation might be. Again, this isn't some mathematical formula, the clue's in the title. What do we think longitudinal observation is? Don't look at this. If you're on the computer, stop looking at this. Longitudinal observation. We couldn't make a general guess about it. Longitudinal observation. Oh, you guys are answering some questions. I'm not going to respond to here. The back. Okay, go on. Let's have a guess. Longitudinal observation. Okay. It's a good thing, but no, that's not directly that. That's a good thought. I think we get some marks for that, an additional thought in there. Longitudinal observation actually is very in vogue now with most UX companies and with most, certainly with most research and with most school works. The way that we do longitudinal observation means that you put your stuff in situ and you observe it over 8 months, 6 months, a year. Okay. When you get, say, Firefox that says to you, would you like to help our development efforts by letting us record what we're doing? That's longitudinal observation. They're observing everything you're doing as a user, the sites you're going to, everything that's happening, every click you make, everything that's going on, so that they can try and make their browsing experience better. That's why it actually the question. But longitudinal observation is far more about observing, since it's in some ways a lot like participant observation, okay, it's a long-term thing, ethnography, but it's instead of trying to elicit information about a process that we need to computerize or we need to make amenable to computation, we are looking at the results of whether the results of our computation make things better or work or do what the users want in a naturalistic setting that's unobtrusive because they don't know that you're evaluating directly or forget about it mostly. And also, it means that it's in the wild, it's in situ, so therefore you don't get these bizarre effects of experimental bias, etc. Guinea pig effects, gone, that kind of thing. Okay, we've got 10 minutes, so let's be back at, actually, let's have another little question. Let's be back at 4:15. Okay, and then we'll go on to the next bit.
Who got one?